fact that Claire Denis was making a science fiction film, these two worlds coming together would be something really special.
This is a radical free idea of a science fiction movie.
The movie's so elliptical and unusual, it feels really audacious and kind of dangerous.
I would call it a spaceship film in the abyss.
It's very difficult to talk about the story in the film because it's changing all the time.
Claire works in a very unique way. You just have to trust her and know that she's a master.
I approached Claire about a possible collaboration, and she said she had a sci-fi idea, which she'd had for a little while. The idea of Claire doing a science fiction film, it was very easy to say yes.
The script for High Life came across my desk. It was a scriptment, which was not the typical 120-page script. It was basically 60 pages, a little bit of dialogue and a lot of exposition.
The script is written in such a poetic, abstract way. I love the way Claire writes.
It just feels so intricately personal, impressionistic. Story from Claire's mind, and she just has a very unusual way of seeing things, and it's what I wanted to do from the beginning, is just try and get into her world.
We were scum, trash, refuse that didn't fit into the system, until someone had the bright idea of recycling us. The agency made us an offer to serve science.
It's the story of a group of prisoners who are on death row, and they get the opportunity to go on a mission into deep space to investigate a black hole, and the mission kind of goes incredibly wrong.
What is there underneath in the script? How many possibilities of interpretation, how many strange things are happening there.
I think the story is not only the one you see, it's more symbolic.
I see in the film some very interesting creation myths. I see the Garden of Eden myth. I see in the film a bit of Noah's flood, and I see in it a bit of a parable for what comes of humans when there are no other choices.
We had to begin the deceleration maneuver so the ship could approach a black hole. This is the main goal of our mission, our Class 1 suicide ride. To check if we could capture a black hole's rotating energy, and we provide humanity with almost boundless resources.
I think science fiction movies is always a chance to reflect what human beings are, how their future maybe will look like. At a certain point, it came to my mind that this is the end of our existence. If mankind becomes allergic against nature, this is the end.
It's scary to think that what goes on in High Life isn't actually that too distant a future away from what we could be dealing with if we continue to treat and disrespect our planet in the way that we do.
It's set in the future, but I think there are some things that go on that hark very much to now, to how inmates are treated and how you have privatized prisons and such, and how they're not really rehabilitated, they just become slaves in a way.
These fucking images from Earth, these fucking viruses chasing after us.
You know what God to pray to? What God are you praying to?
I saw it in some of the random images from Earth. I just wanted to know what they feel.
I see it as a metaphor for how societies work, how human beings are. I think this is what it's about.
It's very difficult to talk about the story in the film because I don't think that the story is the most important. I mean, at least not for me. The most important is the impression you get with these people being stuck in this spaceship, with how they deal with this reality.
Working with Claire, it's not the typical write a script and then cast and then go into production. She likes to build her films from the ground up. She does not like to finish her script before she's casting.
Claire works with actors, and that has a big influence on the way of she writes a script, because she was always change things until the cast is completed.
The script has changed tons, and whoever is cast and however someone decides to play a character.
The casting is international. We're coming from different worlds. That's why Claire wanted to choose very different people.
We speak different languages, and it brings something that we are just learning about each other now on the set.
I think that's important. In particular, I'm coming from a different place, but I think because we're all coming from different places, we just have to figure out who we connect with, who we stand off with, just like this big crew of outcasts.
There's a strange bonding that happens between all the cast just because of the uniqueness of the situation. It's not like any one person is less foreign than another. Everybody's foreign.
Charney can't be your real name, right?
Nah. One of the Russian crew instructors gave it to me. I think it means black, but who knows, man.
All you really know about the characters is that they're all criminals. There are a few moments in the script where there's a professor who explains the situation a bit more as to why the criminals are there. But as far as knowing what crimes they've committed, you don't really need to know.
Claire doesn't want everything to be said. And I think she cultivates a certain mystery around the characters and their past and even their motivation. So we're very free to imagine whatever we want.
Claire doesn't spoon-feed people that come to see her movies every detail that they need to know. In that sense, she really respects her audience. She engages with them. She makes you think.
I made my wife promise to raise our son gently. One thing that makes me happy is knowing he's gonna be all right.
Your son is old now. Or he's dead.
If you're in a prison, at least there are rules which you can follow. With this, none of the characters even know where they're going or what they're doing. They're just drifting, and even the idea of time is completely taken away because it's, you know, after years in space, thousands of years have gone by on Earth, and so it's like, what are they even living for? What are you living for? It's a completely existential situation for them.
You're a bunch of common criminals, petty thugs. My crime was the only one worthy of the name. Dibbs, who's a doctor, she's a criminal, and she would have stayed probably her whole life in prison. So she decided to go on that spaceship and have some experiences as a doctor in the reproduction of human beings.
Dibbs increased the dose when she wanted us at her mercy. We'd all hit the wall and drop like flies.
It's a really hard part. I mean, you look at it and then you could literally play it as a very archetypal, just psychopathic villain. But Juliette, she can't help but give lots of different layers to her performance.
Juliette just conveys so quickly and unmistakably several aspects of that character. You're just thinking, that is such an alluring woman. And so unbelievably dangerous. You just know that there's trouble there. But she's warm. I think it's fascinating to see Juliette bring both those sides.
What you want to give in any genre is humanity, is a human being, and that people believe in what your character is going through. But what I love about this one is that, because acting is so much about the inside, and being connected with an inner place somewhere. And as an actor, of course, it's going through you. It's happening through you. It's you, but not you.
Juliette is constantly present and so ready to just improvise and just go with the flow.
You lied to us. You knew it. When I first saw you, you were a filthy little crackhead. Now look at you. Fine specimen.
There was a scene that was going on where her and Mia were just bouncing off each other, just bouncing back and forth, back and forth, back and forth.
Look, you're fucking killing her!
Oh, calm down.
Being in a scene with her is interesting because she gives you a look and you naturally just react to it.
I'm glad I'm so weak. I'm so happy I'm hemorrhaging.
Be quiet.
Stop lying to yourself. One day it'll happen to you. You're not as strong as you think you are, big booty girl.
One aspect of the movie was how this crew was keeping a life going for a long, long, long time.
My character, Boise, along with Mink and Electra, We're essentially sent to space to act as guinea pigs. And so we're tested and experimented on to see if human reproduction is possible in space. And she doesn't like that at all.
We are trying to have babies, but it doesn't work anymore. So in a way, this is a very dark, very fatalistic view on things.
It gets really violent, and most of us don't make it for different reasons. Many of us die. And Monte ends up alone with his daughter because he has a child with someone from the crew.
Hey, there you go.
The scenes that moved me the most were the scenes with Monte and his daughter. Just the two of them in the spaceship, abandoned, and the relationship between a father and his daughter.
Of course, father and daughter is it's complex. I don't need to quote Freud, but it's something that exists strongly between human being. Probably the character at the beginning, when he's alone, he thinks the best would be to die. But then he cannot. He has this responsibility of this little baby.
I mean, it kind of changed who I thought the character was completely, because Monte was put so much pressure on himself all the time. I thought that he would put that pressure on his daughter afterwards, and that would kind of create this incredibly intense relationship. But then you find just in the performance, you can't really help but be quite soft to when you're with a baby. And I mean, I'd kind of planned to be a lot just stranger and just something which felt wrong with all those scenes. I mean, it's just almost impossible to do that. And I think it sort of softened the whole performance, really.
The child is your daughter, born of your genes. She's strong made, like her big booty mother. Robert was bringing something I had not expected, but I was a little bit afraid, to be honest, because maybe it was too good looking or maybe too precious to me in a way. I thought, oh my God, I have to be aware of that, you know, and not to be afraid by his charisma. I think for me, also is great because there is always something that is hidden. He does not give everything. No, something stayed behind his face. Approaching an actor or an actress with a camera, it's not an easy thing at all. And I knew this mystery in him would help me get close.
So many tears, it's just a tiny little bunny. Stop it, please. Please, stop it. Please, it's gonna kill me. It's gonna kill me.
There's a humility in Robert that is beautiful to watch, and he's really into taking risks. He's ready to serve the story and be there for this world.
Rob's looking to challenge himself and finding directors that inspire him.
Very few things hit me as hard as Claire's work, and I just think if something has a pretty profound effect on you, then just go and try and work with those people.
Robert has been willing to work with Claire to go into her world and having an artistic relationship.
We should try it. I can feel it.
Oh, you can feel it?
I believe in this one.
When you walk through the trenches with Claire, there's a lot of the unknown. And I think that it's exciting, but also challenging for everyone. I think that there is a leap of faith that all these actors have to take and want to take. There's a feeling of making it up as they go along, finding their character, asking questions of why, what motivates me, and sort of just coming upon what they're looking to do as they move forward.
I remember talking to Juliette, being like, I don't know what I'm doing at all. Like, I mean, it's just crazy. And like, and then we went to the Modern Art Museum, and there was this sculpture. And for some reason, just I was looking at this slightly abstract sculpture, and I was like, why does this? This feels like something. And it was a sculpture of a woman breastfeeding. But just the shape of it, and I remember showing this photograph of the sculpture to her, and she was like, yes, that's it. And I was like, and I'd never, I mean, it's almost ridiculous that you can show an abstract sculpture about nothing to do with the movie, and you can show it to a director, and no questions asked, say like, yes, you're right, to make that a part of the character. Most directors would be like, what are you talking about? You need to explain this to me. And it's just being able to think slightly abstractly, I guess it's not really preparation, but it's kind of just getting yourself in a mindset that was kind of different from anything I'd done before.
Claire has a clear vision of what she wants, but she has a tendency to work with her actors to find where she wants to go as the process continues.
I want to fuck you. As an actor, you have to come up with a strong fantasy, or with a strong first suggestion, scene-wise or situation-wise. And in the moment where this is not there, or in the moment where she doesn't get some kind of inspiration by watching you, she's completely desperate from one moment to each other. And this is kind of course, exhausting to have somebody who's so passionate. Whenever I do something and she doesn't like it, and I see her next to the camera, she's doing things like, oh, no, and she makes noises like this. And this is, of course, disturbing, but on the other hand, it really satisfies me because there's such a strong and close relation to somebody else watching you.
Claire, she's no bullshitter. There's something she's following inside that is so genuinely truthful.
She pushes you to go a little deeper. We've had a conversation about my character, and she said, yeah, that's good. We want to go a little deeper than that.
The way she's working is maybe not the easiest, because she's very impulsive and she's very passionate. But this is something I'm here for. This is why I like to be in the movie, because I'm very afraid of conventional movies, and this is something she tries to avoid.
She doesn't do a shot to do a shot. She does it because she wants it, she desires it, she owns it. You feel it's really coming out of her body and mind together, and it's very beautiful to watch.
Claire works from a very visceral place. She's so inspired by the world around her.
She's an artist. She allows herself to invent new things.
She trusts us. She's very confident that we will find our character.
Claire draws inspiration from very disparate places, and she sort of encourages you to do the same thing.
This is a science fiction film. It's a genre film. But the way she takes apart the genre and puts it back together is very much Claire Denis.
Because we shoot the film in Germany and I'm the German producer, to think about the set, to develop this special idea of a spaceship, our budget is so little compared to a big American science fiction movie, so we have to think in a real radical way.
The technology in the film is something that humankind will not have for very many years, and yet it's of today.
I think it's set in the late 70s. Early 80s, because the stuff is not so futuristic. So it's like, you know, it's past future.
I think it's set in an alternate reality,
all of the visual elements could be from the 50s, some things come from the 80s, and I mean, it's just kind of, it's from everywhere.
Claire has really done a lot of research looking at all the current day technology, looking at space stations, looking at Russian cosmonauts, looking at NASA. I think that she's influenced by a little touch of retro, but it's sort of the low-high technology of the not-too-distant future.
ID 14940, I removed the defective section of the external magnetic panel and I replaced it with one of my own making.
We train in a place called the European Space Center where a real astronaut train, and we visit all those places together. And even the computer looked like in the 80s. And I asked why. And they said, till today, there is no better way because this is heavy technology from the 80s and it's very solid.
Do I detect a farewell in your eyes?
You're a skilled pilot. None of the rest of us could do this.
It's difficult to prepare like you had prepared to play an astronaut or something because we're not. We're prisoners. We don't know anything about how to fly a spaceship at all. We're literally just prisoners.
We observe them going through their daily routine and their semblance of a somewhat normal life on board a spaceship in deep isolation.
I thought when we were writing the script that there was a corridor in the middle that was very important, like in a jail, surrounded by the cell. And I thought, wow, this is great, you know? And with the art director, we create something right with the jail shape.
I like it here. This reminds me of Juvie. Reminds me of jail.
One aspect of the movie was how this crew was keeping a life going for a long, long, long time. You know, the kind of ecosystem they were creating.
The garden was very important always. It was the first image of the film always in the script. And so-called fuck box also was important.
When I read the script, I was really like, I can't wait to see this fuck box. Let me see what that's about.
They were my conception of being in jail forever and having this garden and this box to survive, you know? But they were important for me also because it says those prisoners are, they have a relation with Earth, even though maybe Earth does not exist anymore by then.
There's something that really resonates about the terror that we sort of see in the film in the sense of at looking at the sort of barefaced walls and the structured routines and the artificial garden. I think it speaks of something very poignant, which is just that everything is moving so fast and we're sort of unaware of the consequences and we're sort of going on an unknown mission.
Kaliyug, the final age of man.
In the film, something major went wrong. And that the Earth just sort of like couldn't handle all the pollution.
We were at the halfway point. 4 more years to our destination. The main goal of our mission, to check if we could capture a black hole's rotating energy. Their Penrose process.
We were sent out to outer space to get some energy because apparently it is a possibility that we can extract a very large amount of energy from black holes, so it could save humanity.
It was very important for us that everything was at least in principle self-consistent. It is really coming from something which globally makes sense. So we discussed a lot about black holes, about travels in space and therefore travels in time.
They're not being told the truth about...
About what?
That they will never come back. Their messages and reports now take years to get back to us. We'll be bone dust while they're still hurtling through space.
When you are an artist, like Claire Denis is, in my view, you need constraints. So I gave her the laws of physics as constraints. For example, when you go nearly at the speed of light, in the spaceship, time is not lapsing at the same speed somehow than time is moving on Earth. So when the prisoners are living something like 5 years, it is several hundred years on Earth. And those effects of time dilatation are real physical effects, but of course, I think in the movie, there are also psychological effects due to the difference of time perceptions.
At 99% of the speed of light, the entire sky converged before our eyes. The sensation, moving backwards, even though we're moving forwards, getting further from what's getting nearer. Sometimes I just can't stand it.
When you go nearly at the speed of light, the stars are not anymore where they should be, where they are for real. For example, a star which is here will appear to be just in front of you. So the full sky is appearing as an extremely luminous point in front of the spaceship. So that's extremely frightening because you don't recognize your environment anymore. We are dealing with humans lost in space. They are losing their humanity. So I believe constraints allows the artist to create something probably new and something very, I would say, moving.
That's not Manson.
In this movie, black holes are playing a very important role, not only as the objects, the film, but also metaphorically, because black holes in this movie are places where you can break the rules just because they are drastically outside of what is known.
For me, what I liked about the idea of the film from the beginning is being not afraid and going to somewhere nobody has been before. When I told the film to people, I always made this comparison with Christopher Columbus, who sailed to the West and everybody thought the Earth was flat and he would die, he would fall down. But as we know today, he wouldn't. And what the people do here is a little bit the same. From our perspective, we would see they will all die in this black hole. But probably not. Probably they will see something which we've never seen.
In the movie, for example, when this capsule is going to the first black hole, you see inside the capsule, time goes very fast because you are entering the black hole at the speed of light. But the very same phenomenon seen from the spaceship is seen in very, very slow motion. This is not for the beauty of the image. This is for real. For real, people on the spaceship would see the capsule stopping at the black hole, whereas the lady which is inside the capsule goes inside the black hole very fast. And one might wonder, but which viewpoint is correct?
Looks like a crocodile's eye.
Like a mouth that wants to swallow us up.
Visually, the effect is stunning because the shape of the sky is completely changed by the presence of a black hole. And for the second black hole which appears in the movie, the father and his daughter are wondering if they should go inside. They don't know what they will find, and they discover a kind of ring of light around them. From the astrophysical viewpoint, it means that time ends. But probably they don't feel death. They feel something else. We don't know what they feel. So we don't know. Maybe they will die, but maybe they will really live or really face something that couldn't be expected from outside. So it's a dangerous game, but this is just the point of the movie, I think.
The last image of the movie, when they go into a black hole, there's black on the one hand side and black on the other hand side. So for me, this is kind of the light circle represents life and our existence, and it's just a glimpse. It's, I think, in a way, our lives are more about what comes after and beforehand. So we don't know where we are coming from and we don't know where we are going to. And this is, in a way, the story that has been told.